All rise.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Chair and Commissioner Musi. Today we're ready to lead the evidence of the former President, Mr. Thabo Mbeki. And I beg leave that he be sworn in.
Thank you.
Chair and Commissioner Musi, before we deal with the evidence of the former president, there is one housekeeping matter I would like to deal with. And this relates to a document that inadvertently slipped into the statement during the course of photocopying the statement. That is a document which is dated Wednesday, 6 August 2008. It is a Hansard recording of certain parliamentary proceedings in which the former president was responding to certain questions put to him in parliament. It was never the intention of the evidence leaders nor the team representing the former president to have this as part of the statement. And to the extent that it has become part, we would beg leave for that to be removed from the statement.
Thank you. I have seen that, and I was wondering what that document wants in the bundle. And clearly, if you read the statement, that document doesn't form part of that statement. So I don't think that should be a problem.
Your observation is correct, Chair, and we are indebted to the Chair. Mr. Mbeki, during the course of giving evidence, you are required to speak into the microphone, and for purposes of facilitating the proper record, it is required that one person speaks into the mic at the time. You will see that every time I ask a question, my mic will be on, at the conclusion of which I will switch it off, and when you respond, you just press the mic to facilitate the recording. Now, having dealt with those housekeeping matters, it is correct that on the on the 16th of July, you signed a statement. Do you confirm that?
Yes, and I confirm that.
You have been furnished with a copy of your statement, and if you look, turn to page 4 of the statement, there is a signature that appears there. Will you confirm that is your signature?
Yes, it is, Chairperson.
Now, as I pointed out, the statement is made up of 4 pages, which deal with the issues you intend to assist the Commission with, especially in relation to the role you played, either as Deputy President of the Republic of South Africa or as President of the Republic of South Africa in relation to the acquisition of the special defense packages. Is that correct?
Yes.
May I ask you to have regard to paragraph one of your statement, where you state the capacity in which you would be giving evidence before the commission. Now, I suppose the commissioners can take judicial notice of the fact that in 1994, you were appointed as one of the deputy presidents of the Republic of South Africa. You confirm that?
Yes, that is correct, commissioners.
You served in that position up to the middle of 1999, is that correct?
That is also correct.
After the elections in 1999, you were then elected as the President of the Republic of South Africa, is that correct?
That is also correct, commissioners.
Now, evidence has been tendered before the commission, starting with, among others, former Minister Alec Erwin, Minister Lekota, and subsequently former Minister Manuel, with regard to the existence of a formation referred to as the Interministerial Committee, also known as the IMC, which was a subcommittee of cabinet. Do you confirm that?
Yes, indeed, I would confirm that.
And in terms of the evidence before the commission, you were the chairperson of that interministerial committee.
That is correct, commissioners.
Now, in terms of the role you played as the chairperson of that committee, are you able to just briefly describe to the commissioners exactly what your position entailed as chairperson of the interministerial committee?
Well, commissioners, as chair, one had to chair the committee. And really, it's a supervisory sort of role with the detailed work with regard to that whole package, with the detailed work being done at the ministerial level. So the responsibility of the chair in that case would be to make sure that we meet as a committee, that we address the matter of that procurement in the context of what might have been decided as to what it is that we wanted to achieve, and then to ensure that the necessary reports were given to cabinet. Thanks.
The various former ministers who have given evidence before this commission, before you, have given evidence with regard to the role that this IMC, or the Interministerial Committee, or the Subcommittee of Cabinet, as you wish, played, inter alia being to provide executive oversight over the acquisition process of the special defense packages. Now, as far as you recall, could you just briefly state, although I may point out that this has already, evidence to that effect has already been presented to the commission, but in your role as the chairperson of this subcommittee, could you just briefly explain the sequence of events that led to the decisions that were ultimately taken to procure?
Can I just ask members of the media to not to try and interrupt our proceedings, please? I see them walking up and down and also in the process also distracting the former deputy president when he's testifying. Can we just make sure that there's no up and down movements when the witness testifies.
Thank you, Chair, and I beg your pardon, Mr. President. May I seek permission? I know you no longer president. May I refer you to you as Mr. President?
Well, if that does not violate any protocol or law or values or something, I'm sure commissioners, you can call me anything. Thanks.
Yes, for purposes of these proceedings, I shall refer to you as Mr. President. Now, I was in the process when I was interrupted to ask you to just briefly describe the sequence of events that culminated in the decision ultimately to procure the SDPs as they are referred to, starting perhaps with the rationale, therefore, as provided for in the Constitution.
Well, the commissioners, of course, I can only state this matter very broadly. We're talking about events that took place more than 16 years ago. there was an obligation on government arising out of what the Constitution says about the need to have a defense force which would carry out various tasks in terms of protecting the country, etc. So there was that requirement. In any case, the government was aware of the fact that National Defense Force needed re-equipping in any case. when we came into government, the then government, it came into government in 1994, the then government had was on the verge of signing a contract to buy 4 corvettes. We discussed that matter. And said that it would be wrong to approach the matter of these acquisitions in a piecemeal manner. That what would be necessary is that we have a complete look at all the needs of the National Defense Force, so that then we are better able to decide what to do with obviously what would be limited resources. What you'd spend for each of the services, whether it's the Army or the Air Force or the Navy or the medical services and so on. So I'm saying that there were these two considerations, the constitutional one and the reality that we knew that National Defense Force required re-equipping. As a consequence of which then it was decided that we should... Minister of Defense should prepare this defense white paper, which was done, and commissioners, as you are aware, the white papers are a government policy, not departmental. They might be put out by particular ministries. So we discussed the white paper and agreed in cabinet, so it went forward and discussed in parliament, and as again you would recall, it talked about the need for a defense review, which again was done, which then decided all these things about force structure and so on. So that was the process. And once we had completed that, and there was indeed the overall view in the country, including in parliament, unanimously in parliament, that indeed we needed re-equipping the defense force in the manner that was visualized, We then proceeded to go ahead with the procurement process. Thanks.
And it is so that this procurement process was preceded by a further step that was taken subsequent to the adoption of the defense white paper, which is referred to as the defense review. And it is...
There's a particular history that attaches to the armed forces here, in that the SADF, South African Defense Force, was part of the forces of repression. This was part of what the apartheid regime used in order to suppress the struggle here. So we're sensitive to the fact that it was necessary in a democratic South Africa to reposition the national defense was in the eyes of the people of the country. And of course, it also had other negative experience with regard to the region. The SADF had been a big source of instability in the region, lots of people killed and destroyed and so on. So we thought it was important that the population as a whole should really have a new attitude towards the National Defense Force, and therefore that even these matters about equipping it and so on, there should be a kind of a national ownership of this. So, I mean, we could have, as an executive, we could have taken all the decisions we needed about this, but we thought it was necessary to engage the South African public, including Parliament, as I say, so that indeed everybody gets a sense of ownership of this, in addition to which, of course, is a consideration that we would have to spend significant sums of money to purchase this equipment, that even that, the population generally had to take on board, having better understood what the South African National Defense Force, as opposed to the South African Defense Force, stood for, would do, and so on. And indeed, we're very pleased that that very inclusive process of consultation with the population came out with an outcome which said to us in government that we'd manage to that extent to shift the attitude of the population towards the National Defense Force away from what the population would have known of the Apartheid Defense Force, to understand that here you have a new entity consistent with this new South Africa. And that's what I would say, Commissioners, in response to this question that's been posed.
And during the course of this public process that was undertaken, with the coming into power of the new government, there were also imperatives to address socio-economic rights. And what would your comment be with regard to the decision that was ultimately taken to procure the arms in the context of the debates that prevailed at the time regarding the socio-economic rights of the majority of the population?
Well, Commissioners, the again, as the Commission would be aware, the country faced many different challenges, many different needs which needed to be addressed. There's none of them important demands, none of which could be postponed. You couldn't say there are challenges with regard to access to clean water. No, let's postpone acting on that until we've built more clinics. You couldn't. So here we've got a whole spread of challenges and things that to be done, which would have been reflected, for instance, in the reconstruction and development program as was adopted by cabinet. So this particular matter, which, as I was saying earlier, in terms of the constitution certainly, and certainly of the needs that we knew, would have to be addressed. That is the re-equipping of the defense force. This is one of the many matters with which government has got to deal. So in dealing with that issue, we had to see in how do we balance these expenditures on all sorts of things, expenditure on education, on health, on defense force, on the police, on all sorts of things. How do you balance this thing so that you achieve the best possible result with regard to advancing all of these objectives which we had to do? And I've been told, Commissioners, that My colleague, Trevor Manuel, and people at Treasury have dealt in some detail with this particular matter, and I'm quite sure that I have absolutely nothing to add or subtract from what they have said. But one of the consequences of that is that we reduced quite sharply the expenditure on the defense, as a proportion of GDP, and in of the budget. It may very well be, commissioners, I'm not making this as a definitive statement. I haven't done any measurement. But looking at it now, at some retrospect, I think it may even be that we reduced it too radically. In the end, it will have a negative consequence on the National Defense Force, inevitably. But it was in order, commissioners, to deal with the question that has been posed about how do we balance all of these needs, needs about economic development. Where do you get the money to invest in economic infrastructure? Social spending, foreign affairs, the country has got to reopen up to the rest of the world after all these years of isolation. How do you balance all of these things? I'm saying that balancing was done, and I'm quite sure that Trevor Manuel and the officials at Treasury have given a detailed account of how this was done and its outcome. And thank you very much, commissioners.
So in essence, what this process or the decision was based on to acquire these armaments was also informed by the balancing act that was undertaken at the time, regard being had to government's policy of reconstruction and development. So that's basically it.
Yes, indeed, absolutely. That's it. Yeah.
And having regard to the need of the Defense Force, the South African Defense Force at the time, as described in the evidence of, amongst others, Admiral Green and the various other officials from the SANDF, there was, in fact, a dire need. The equipment had become obsolete and had to be replaced. So there was a need to deal with the matter as soon as possible without delay. Would you agree with that?
Yes, no, commissioners, I would agree with that. I would say, for instance, effectively, we did not have a navy. You had sailors were on the state payroll and so on, but no ships to sail in. Which is why it was correct, even for the previous government, the decision to acquire those three corvettes was correct in itself, because they were needed, as was again confirmed by the defense review. So, I mean, re-equipping of the defense, National Defense Force was, it was clear, it was obvious and logical. Thanks, commissioners.
And also with regard to the envisaged acquisition, it is so that it was intended for the equipment to be acquired to be modern and be in line with the advancement in technology at the time that these decisions was made. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct, Commissioner.
And that is also a view that is expressed in the defense review, that in equipping the South African Defense Force, it was necessary to have modern equipment which would be or would enable those who operate it to be able to operate it elsewhere in the world other than the Republic in the event that that need therefore arose.
Yes, that would be correct, because I'm the part of the kind of military policy that we're developing also included visualizing our contributing to peacekeeping efforts on the continent. So we had to be able to have that kind of outreach beyond the borders of the country. Thanks.
So if one has regard again to what is stated in the last part of paragraph one to your statement, it is recorded there that the subcommittee of cabinet played a role in giving effect to the decisions of cabinet regarding the strategic defense procurement packages. What would you, in brief, describe these decisions of cabinet be with regard to the procurement of these packages, among others?
Well, commissioners, I mean, the first decision, of course, would have been that we must take the necessary steps to make sure that this equipment is acquired. And therefore, various structures would have been established to process this matter. I'm talking about structures below the ministerial committee, who would then look at the matter and then recommend to the ministerial committee. So one of the decisions would be that. There would have been other decisions like, for instance, a decision that says, let us look at affordability. Once you'd said, this is what we're going to get, which is a matter which the Treasury, the Minister of Finance and Treasury would have dealt with, but they would have reported to the ministerial committee in the first instance. So ministerial committee would have to look at that to see whether what has come out of that is a matter that can properly be reported to cabinet, would process it to that extent. I mean, I'm sure that would have happened also with regard to the first reports of the negotiating team, which then had to negotiate final contracts with the preferred bidders, that cabinet would have said, set up this thing and let it do whatever. And then the ministerial committee would have had oversight of the work of that negotiating team, so that by the time the report comes to cabinet, it would have been processed by the ministerial committee. Thanks.
Now, we have already touched on your role as the chairperson of this interministerial committee, and you have testified that the various ministers who formed part of this committee were responsible for the functions in their respective divisions. For instance, the late Minister Joe Mudise, as Minister of Defense at the time, would have been responsible for defense matters. Former Minister Manuel would be responsible for financial and treasury matters. Former Minister Erwin would have been responsible for issues relating to the national issues relating to the national trade and industry, also regarding the industrial policy that had been developed by cabinet at the time. Now, while these individual and respective ministers were responsible individually for their departments, is it so that as members of the IMC, they would discuss the matters relating to their respective departments jointly as members of the IMC and perhaps seek to reach consensus at that point?
Yeah, I should say, commissioners, there was another member of the member of the IMC, that's the Minister of Public Enterprises, that we haven't mentioned. That's important because it relates to for instance, your dips, because you are dealing with state corporations in the military defense sector. So I'm saying that we didn't mention the commissioner, that commissioners, the fact that you also had the minister of public enterprises as member of the ministerial committee. Now, the particular matter of processing matters relevant to each ministry, of course, would first of all be done by the minister concerned, which report in the end would come as all other reports from the lower structures would then ultimately come to the ministerial committee as recommendations. So that's what would happen. And sure, as a ministerial committee, I'm quite sure that in instances where this might have been necessary, we would have had a look at ensuring that there is coherence. There is coherence in terms of the decisions that are being taken, affecting different departments and ministries.
And this, to an extent, is what the Constitution in Section 85 refers to as coordinating functions of cabinet. You find that the late minister, Stella Sigcau, as Minister of Public Enterprises at the time, would be looking at the impact that the procurement would have with regard to the defense industry. Minister Ewen would also have regard, together with his department, on the impact that would be achieved with the leveraging of industrial participation from the various bidders and so forth. Is that how this was intended to function?
Yes, certainly I would imagine that, yes, that's how the matter would have proceeded.
Now, if you turn to paragraph 4 of your statement, it appears on page 2 thereof. It is recorded there. This is after you have indicated that you, together with other members of the Interministerial Committee, had taken a decision to assist the Commission in every manner possible in the discharge of its functions. You record there at paragraph 4 that in that context it is important to make the point that none of the members of the IMC acted in their personal capacities when executing the functions as members of the executive. Could you just briefly expand on the import of what you say there?
Yes, commissioners. I thought it was important to make the statement because you see a lot of over the years, you've seen a lot of comment which seems to attribute particular actions, government actions, to individuals. Policies and actions, which is not how our government functioned. As I was saying that earlier, commissioners, when you, as the commission knows, when you talk about a defense white paper, which is tabled in parliament by the Minister of Defense, it is in fact a cabinet document. It's a decision of cabinet. So the cabinet has discussed it and so on. So, you could say, in a colloquial sense, that Minister of Defense has said, but it's only colloquial. So, and that's the point we're trying to make here. And therefore, that the decisions that came from the ministerial committee were not decisions that were made by the members of the ministerial committee acting in their individual capacities. They had to report. Our senior committee was the cabinet. We had to report to the cabinet. This is what we're recommending, and explain why. they were recommending whatever, and the cabinet would then take a decision. So I thought it was important to understand this. I'm saying because you get this quite a lot, this a rather strange notion that major decisions of government are taken by individuals as though you have the capacity, the possibility to do a thing like that. At least nobody did when I was in government. Thanks.
And in that vein, that would also exclude you from having taken any particular decision regarding the SDPPs in your personal capacity or in your capacity as president or in your capacity as chairperson of the IMC.
Yes, commissioners, I mean, there are no decisions that were taken by the chair of the ministerial committee or the deputy president or the president of the country. There are no individual decisions that were taken with regard to this. All decisions, all the final decisions with regard to this matter were cabinet decisions.
You point out in paragraph 6 that the former ministers, your colleagues, have already given evidence to the commission with regard to material issues that arose with regard to their participation in various decisions involving the SDPPs, and you say in paragraph 7 you endorse the evidence given in that respect. Do you still confirm that?
Yes, commissioners, I definitely do confirm that.
Now, once the decision to procure these packages had been taken, the implementation thereof was left to the various officials within the SAN Defense Force and the other departments that participated in the process. That process culminated in a cabinet, a briefing to the interministerial committee, which, according to the evidence before the commission, took place on 31 August 1998, where a recommendation was adopted in terms of which certain equipment would be sourced from their recommended suppliers. Do you recall that?
No, commissioners, no, I don't recall this meeting. It would have taken place in 1998. That's what. How many years ago was that? 16 or something? No, I don't. Thanks.
In fact, to that effect, there is what appears to be a recordal of the proceedings of that meeting, and in respect of which Minister Kessrels gave evidence as to what motivated the decision to procure some of the equipment from certain suppliers. And I believe you possibly would be aware of one controversial program in these packages, which was the acquisition of the Hawk from BAE. Do you have any recollection, vague or somewhat detailed, about this matter?
Well, commissioners, I would presume that both Ron Castrels, who at this time was Deputy Minister of Defence, and the officials and officers from the Defence Department and National Defence Force, I'm sure they would have addressed this matter. But as I recollect the discussion, when the recommendation came to the ministerial committee from the lower committees about this particular issue, a trainer, Now, this is a trainer for the Gripen. As I recall it, there was a proposal about two options that the ministerial committee could agree to option one or it could agree to option two. In terms of option one, I think the Italian trainer was the preferred trainer in terms of option one. And in terms of the second option, the hawk was. And the difference here was that what had to be decided really was the Italian trainer would be cheaper than the hawk. But the hawk would have certain advantages over the Italian in terms of compatibility with the Gripen. Therefore, from the point of view of training of pilots and you know, whatever else the Air Force does, from that point of view, the Hawk was a better plane, but it was a more expensive plane. So, as Ministerial Committee were to take a decision, in reality, which was does cost trump this compatibility and other advantages, or does compatibility and these other advantages trump cost? So a choice had to be made, and we decided that let us go with the Hawk, and then see how we manage the cost implications of that within the totality of the budget that would be allocated for this purpose. So I think that's the decision, not as I recall it. I would imagine that, as I was saying, the then Deputy Minister Castrils and officers from National Defense Force and officials from department might have a more detailed explanation about this. But I think broadly, commissioners, I think that was what the issue was, and that's how we arrived at a decision, which then, of course, was a decision and that was then adopted finally by cabinet.
And would you recall if there was any detailed presentation with regard to the costing of both these programs furnished to the Interministerial Committee at the time that it had to apply its mind to the recommendation coming from the lower committees?
Well, Commissioner, I don't know. These matters about cost would obviously have featured in terms of the report coming from the committees below to say we had shortlisted the following whatever. And we think this one is best, this is number one, number two, and they would have explained on what basis this one becomes first and second. So to that extent, there would have been a discussion of the financial elements of that. But I would imagine that there would have been a much more extensive discussion of this matter once the Minister of Finance, it came with the affordability study, looking at the totality of the budget. I would imagine that might have been the occasion to have a more comprehensive discussion about the money matters. Thanks.
And perhaps for the assistance of the Commission, the issues relating to the choice of the Hawk and the affordability and rationale, the commissioners would find in the transcript of proceedings at the following references, page 7187, lines 4 to 25. And with regard to affordability, these appear in the evidence again of former Minister Trevor Manuel at page 7188, as from line 4, and page 7198, as from line 1. It continues at page 7201, line 10, to 7203, line 22. That's where the detail of the affordability study and the acquisition of the entire package appears to have been dealt with in his evidence. And I believe these matters would have been canvassed during the meetings of the interministerial committee over which you presided.
Yes, that is correct, commissioners.
There's an issue raised in paragraph 8 of your statement regarding the extensive litigation relevant to the issue around the validity of the contracts that were subsequently concluded and the affordability of the packages. As I recall through the evidence, again, of former Minister Manuel, that litigation involved you at that time having been cited in your capacity as the President of the Republic. Do you have any recollection independent of having refreshed your mind about it regarding that litigation?
No, commissioners, I wouldn't. I mean, I recall indeed that as has been stated, I was cited as the president in this instances, and indeed as government, we then decided that the Minister of Finance and Treasury would take the lead in terms of responding to this issue. So we didn't therefore deal with it in any direct and detailed sense. Thanks.
Now, having dealt with that matter, perhaps it might be appropriate to just digress, take a step or two back, that after the recommendations was made to the interministerial committee at the meeting, in terms of which the evidence suggests, was on 31 August 1998, to approve certain suppliers. This matter, is it correct, was considered by the Interministerial Committee, and it in turn made in September 1998. Do you recall that? September 1999, I beg your pardon. Do you recall that?
Yes, commissioners, the process was that, as I was saying, there would be committees below the ministerial committee that would look at all of these matters in the detail and then come and report to the ministerial committee and make recommendations to the ministerial committee, which would then discuss those prior to forwarding them to the cabinet. So, sure, at some point, there would have been a time when the ministerial committee, having looked at the recommendations that would have come from the committees below, would then have gone to cabinet and made various recommendations. And as I recall it, the cabinet actually accepted the recommendations that were made by the ministerial committee. So I'm saying, commissioners, I can't confirm the exact dates, whether the date was on the 9th of January or March or February or whatever. But at some point, the recommendations were made to the ministerial committee, including which recommended all of these things, which ultimately became the decision of the cabinet. There may very well have been this meeting which took place somewhere in Durban in 98, it may very well have happened. if it didn't happen, it would have happened. If it didn't happen then, it would have happened at some other point. but in the end, the fact of the matter is, Cabinet took certain decisions based on recommendations made by the IMC, which IMC itself would have listened to presentations made to it by other committees.
In fact, if you have regard to paragraph 9 of your statement, you state there that the record shows that in November 1998, Cabinet approved the preferred suppliers for each of the equipment types comprising the SDPP, and Cabinet simultaneously at that point requested that matters relating to affordability should be investigated. So in November 1998, Cabinet took a decision with the caveat that the affordability of the packages be investigated.
Commissioners, yes, that is correct.
Now, it is common cause now, and through the evidence of former Minister Manuel, that the exercise relating to the investigation of the affordability was undertaken, and it, on the evidence before the Commission, a presentation thereof of the affordability study was made to the Interministerial Committee around September 1999. Do you have any recollection of that without the aid of any document at this point?
No, what the only thing I can say, commissioners, is that indeed there was a report presented. We discussed it, and then having satisfied ourselves that it had addressed what Cabinet had said must be addressed, we took it back to Cabinet. What month that was, and so on, or even the detail of the discussion, I can't recall now.
Now, in paragraph 10, you state that when Cabinet was finally satisfied that it had attained an affordable contracting position that government could support, it took a decision in December 1999 in which it authorized the signing of the contracts with the successful suppliers. Do you recall that decision being taken by Cabinet?
Yes, commissioners, I do. I do. Indeed, this is a decision as is recorded here.
Could you just briefly set out the circumstances surrounding the decision being taken, if you recall?
Well, Commissioner, I'm not quite sure that I understand that question, but I mean, this is a culmination of a process. A decision having been taken, National Defense Force needs re-equipping, and go through a process to say this is how it needs to be re-equipped, and then pose the question, is it affordable? At the end of all of that process, a cabinet in December 99 said, well, all of these matters have been addressed, and in terms of the negotiations with the preferred bidders, what we required needed to be done with those preferred bidders in terms of the negotiations has been done, and therefore we can now proceed to sign the contracts with the successful suppliers. So I'm saying really, I think, Commission, it really just represents a culmination of this process which started quite earlier when these various decisions were taken to do this procurement.
In paragraph 11 of your statement, you state that you have at all times held the firm conviction that the decisions of Cabinet, I presume this is in relation to the SDPP, were compliant with the Constitution and within the constitutional mandates conferred on cabinet. Why was it necessary to include this statement or this assertion in your statement?
Well, commissioners, I'm saying this because there are some matters that have been in the public domain for some time, which some of which have suggested that there was something wrong. wrong, even probably constitutionally wrong, in terms of a government deciding to go for this requisition in the light of the various demands that the country has for houses and this and that and the other, to make the point that people shouldn't cherry pick what the Constitution says. It requires a defense force of a particular kind. It describes it, as the Commission knows, the task of this defense force. So so to that extent, I'm saying that the decisions taken by government were compliant with the Constitution. And it also relates to matters that belong within the mandate of the National Executive, as defined in the Constitution. Because again, I've heard that there's been some argument presented that once the cabinet had agreed on all of these things, the affordability issue and so on, it needed to go to Parliament to have that endorsed. It's clearly wrong. What happens is that the budget, national budget, as I'm sure the Commission is perfectly aware, national budget is approved by Parliament. What would have happened in this particular case is that all costs that government incurs, as this one, must be provided for. They must be necessary the funds have to be found. Those funds have to be approved by the National Parliament. So that matter, therefore, would have gone to Parliament via that national budget. The funds that would be allocated to finance this acquisition. Not that if Cabinet wants to buy 20 chairs, it must go to Cabinet to Parliament to get permission to buy, to acquire 20 chairs. There's no such requirement. But that purchase, in terms of the national budget, must reflect. So, and that's why we're making these references to these constitutional matters, because, as I say, because of some things which somehow have been put in the public domain, seeming to suggest that somehow the government had acted in a manner that was unconstitutional. Thanks.
Now, you would have seen that brought us to the conclusion of your statement, as I understand it. Is there anything else with regard to the role that you played, either as Deputy President of the Republic or President of the Republic, or the chairperson of the IMC, in relation to the acquisition of the packages, that you would like to add, which is not included in your statement?
No, commissioners, I can't think of anything. I think we've said whatever needed to be said, but of course the commission may want to ask some further questions. I don't know. We'll be available to answer those. Thanks.
Chair and Commissioner Musi, that is the evidence in chief of the President Mbeki.
Thank you, Advocate Sibeko. Is there any person who will be interested to cross-examine the former State President?
Mr. Mr. Commissioner, my name is Paul Hoffman. We haven't met mainly because you refused to meet me when I tried to meet you.
You are right. I refused to meet you. Late in the evening in my office, I wouldn't talk to any of the parties involved. You are correct. I refused to meet you.
I want to cross-examine the witness on behalf of Terry Crawford Brown, who is sitting next to me in this meeting. Thank you, please.
I think just for the record, Mr. Paul Hoffman is correct. I refuse to meet him. He came to the office together with his client. I was sitting and working at about 7 p.m. Then I was told that they want to meet me. I refused. And the reason is simple. You can't see any of the parties or one of the contestants in the absence of other parties. And for that reason, I said to my secretary, tell Mr. Paul Hoffman I will not meet him. He is correct. Before I go to the next person, Mr. Paul Hoffman, who is the instructing attorney, so that we can get our records straight.
I'm here on the instructions of Charles Abrams, who has been in correspondence with the commission over various matters over the past few years.
Thank you. I'll tell you why I was asking that question, because I thought at some stage we received a letter from them saying that they're no longer acting for him. I might be incorrect. But then if they're still acting for him, that is fine. That will also help us to try and arrange with him for the statement of Mr. Taylor Crawford Brown in order to prepare a statement so that he can come in and testify. Advocate Ndume, you've got it. So we know who to contact in order to try and arrange the statement of Mr. Taylor Crawford Brown. Thank you, Mr. Hoffman. Any other person who might want to...
Sorry, before we move on, there's already been negotiation with Advocate Madumbi in relation to the availability of Mr. Crawford Brown, who is willing to assist the commission, but unfortunately has to attend a conference in Turkey.
I'm not dealing with that issue now.
We'll worry about that ourselves.
I'm not dealing with the question of his availability on the date that we have subpoenaed him to come and testify. That we'll deal with it at a later stage. Yes. Can I get any other person who might want to cross-examine the former state president?
Chairperson, yes. De Vos and Ms. Snyman, on behalf of Lawyers for Human Rights, would request the opportunity to cross-examine Mr. Mbeki.
Thank you. I think that seems to be the only two people. Just so that we can get our timing correct, Mr. Hoffman, more or less, how long do you think that your cross-examination will take, more or less?
Mr. Commissioner, that's a very difficult question
just
to answer.
Just a rough estimation. I'm not going to hold you to that.
I imagine that I will take most of the rest of the day.
Most of the rest of the day. Okay, thank you. And Advocate De Vos, just a very rough estimation.
It's obviously very difficult to say. It depends on the answers that we receive from the questions that's going to be put to the witness. But it may take an hour or two. Okay. I'm not as optimistic as Mr. Hoffman about the time.
Thank you, Advocate De Vos. I think this might be the right moment to take a tea adjournment, and we'll come back after 20 minutes. Thank you.
hear?
Can you confirm that they're still under oath? Mr. Hoffman?
Later. That sounds more like I have less competition. May I proceed, Mr. Commissioner?
I'm not quite sure. I see one of the microphones next to former president seems to be on. Will that affect the recordings or not? Thank you. Mr. Hoffman, you can go ahead then.
There's another one at the midpoint between us, but if the technicians are happy, I'm happy. I just don't want to be a fly in the ointment, as they say.
Apparently, they are happy.
Good. Mr. Mbeki, and please forgive us for calling you Mr. Mbeki, but we prefer the precedent set by your predecessor, President Mandela, who chose not to be called president after his term of office. The evidence that you've given this morning is a short summary of a matter which is not really in an adversarial domain. What we are busy with here, as you know, is a presidential commission of inquiry appointed by President Jacob Zuma to enable him to be better advised as to what happened many years ago, and some of it is a very long time ago, in relation to the acquisition of arms by South Africa after the new South Africa dawned, and what followed in terms of implementation of what are called offset deals by the press. So I do not seek to have an adversarial conversation with you. I seek to elucidate facts and sort out in chronological order what is what we hope is germane to what the Commission has to do if it is properly going to discharge the very onerous mandate which has been given to it by President Zuma.
Mr. Hoffman, can we get to the cross-examination, please?
Yes, we can do that. Can you tell us what position, prior to becoming Deputy President of South Africa, did you hold in the ANC?
These questions will assist the Commission in arriving at decisions which it's mandated to in terms of its terms of reference. And obviously, Chairperson, you will control the manner of asking questions, but for the life of me, I do not see the relevance of this question.
Mr. Hoffman, is there... Do you have any reply to that? Because I'm not quite sure whether the position that the former president held within the ANC at that time has got any relevance with what we are doing now.
It really relates to how it happened that he became the deputy president. That's really, it's a leading question to why it was that he became deputy president in 1994. But if it worries my learned friend, Mr. Morani, then I don't need to ask it. I can simply go straight to you were deputy president from 1994 to 1999. Is that correct?
Just hold on. Let's leave out the ANC if at all it's not relevant. Get straight to your questions. He was a deputy president at that time. We all know that.
There is a need for a record, and that is why I'm asking the question.
Yes, indeed I was. Thanks.
And during the term of your deputy presidency, You were effectively the Prime Minister of South Africa. You were the hands-on day-to-day person running the show. Your president was a reconciler and a nation builder rather than a day-to-day mechanical operator. Is that a fair summary of what was happening in the early years that you were in cabinet?
No, commissioners, it is not. President Mandela was the head of state and head of government and functioned as such. There was no suggestion that anybody played a role of a prime minister by a position which we don't have. no suggestion whatsoever. No, the description is wrong. thanks.
You regarded yourself as his deputy.
Not that I regarded myself as such, I was. So I was appointed and so on. So I was deputy president together with Deputy President F.W. de Klerk.
And when it came to this arms acquisition, you were the president, the chairman of the interministerial committee that was seized with the task of finding the right balance and mix in relation to the acquisition of arms.
Yes, I chaired the interministerial committee appointed by cabinet to have oversight of that over that process.
And when did that committee cease to function?
Oh, I would imagine, I haven't checked on that, but I would imagine that it would have ceased to function once it had completed its work.
You don't have a date or that you can remember?
I'm afraid I don't, Commission.
What I'm going to do next, Mr. Mbeki, is try to place a chronological context on how it came about that South Africa spent what was initially going to be 6 billion rand on armaments, which was then revised to 10 billion rands, and by the time the deal was done, it was 30 billion rands, and if we read in the newspapers today, it is 90 billion rands. What I want to do is put all of that in chronological context. On the basis of your particular role.
Just so then, Mr. Hoffman. Advocate Myron.
Chairperson, a learned colleague is putting misleading statements. There was never any stage where the cost of this acquisition was going to be 6 billion rand.
And then, secondly, Mr. Hoffman, if I remember, we have heard a lot of evidence, even from Treasury. Nobody ever mentioned 90 billion rand. I'm not sure where you get that figure from.
Right. The figure to which Mr. Marani is complaining is the one in the Defence Review way back in the 90s, and the 90 billion is the figure that is now being, and as I put it, bandied about. I don't say it's an accurate figure. In the press today.
Can we just try and stick to facts? If you're told you are going to lead any evidence about the 90 billion rand that you're talking about, yeah. I think you can continue with your question. If you're not, please try and refrain from making statements which you will be unable to justify at a later stage. I haven't seen any 90 billion rand. I've had witnesses from National Treasury. I've had witnesses from DTI. None of them spoke about 90 billion rand. Maybe let's just leave out that figure from the equation, because otherwise your question will be misleading.
As the Commission pleases, when you became Deputy President, the situation in the South African Defence Force as it then was that there had been severe budget cuts and staff cuts. They weren't in a healthy state. Is that a fair statement? I'm talking now about the period between 1989 when the end of apartheid began to dawn, and 1992, which is when the CODESA process began. Is that a fair statement, Mr. Mbeki?
I don't know, commissioners. I've never studied what would happen to the National Defense Force before 94, so I really don't know.
Sorry, that's a fair answer, and I can't expect you to give evidence about stuff you don't know about. But you did mention that there was talk, and my date is March 1993, that the Navy, the SA Navy, as it then was looking to purchase 4 new corvettes from Spain. I think you mentioned that in passing in your evidence in chief this morning. Is that correct?
I mentioned, commissioners, was that when we came into government in 94, we found that a government had acted to acquire 4 corvettes, indeed from Spain, but that the contract had not been signed.
That is correct. We're on the same page. That was what was under review. They are much smaller vessels, much cheaper vessels than the vessels that were eventually acquired under the arms procurement package. Is that right?
I don't know.
Now, my instructions are that in the period the 6th to the 14th of January 1995, you are now Deputy President, you traveled to Germany and you told the German Foreign Minister that the race is still open for companies to submit tenders for the corvettes. Do you remember ever saying that?
No, I don't, but I'm sure we can check with that former Foreign Minister of Germany as to that, but I don't.
He was the Foreign Minister, and I'm sure we can. It was reported at the time, and my source of this information is a well-known South African historian whose name is Paul Holden, who has spent many years crouched over a computer screen researching the arms deals, as you probably know.
No, Commissioner, I'm afraid I don't know him. I don't even know of him. But I'm saying that, sure, he might have said what you say he said, but I can't recall any such thing.
Not in a position to dispute what he has said about what happened when you visited Germany in January 95.
No, I'm not. He may, commissioners, he might have been told by the German Foreign Minister that's what I said to the Foreign Minister, because I can't remember Mr. Holden being present in meetings I had with the German Foreign Minister. But he would have got this information somehow. And maybe if the German Foreign Minister told him that, I don't know. But I can't recollect it.
Do you recall that the corvette deal was scrapped, the intention to get corvettes, that idea was scrapped in June of 1995 when the Cameron Commission of Inquiry was in full flow and there was intense public criticism of the idea of spending money on corvettes while half of the population of South Africa is living in poverty and shacks and less than ideal circumstances. Do you remember that happening, that the Spanish deal never happened?
Just hold on before former president can respond. I don't quite understand the question. Can you perhaps rephrase the question?
Yes.
I know that, you know, according to the evidence that we have, that the earlier attempts to acquire the corvettes were stopped because of the defense review. That's what the Navy said to us. They said the idea was that they must go through the defense review so that there can be national consensus on the requirements of the SANDF. That is the evidence that I have. Now you have added quite a lot of other things that I didn't quite understand what you are saying about the other things that you said.
Sorry, Mr. Commissioner, if I put too many things in one hit, I will break the questions up more and we will be here longer. But the reason that Holden gives for the scrapping of the plan to get Spanish corvettes is that the public was unhappy about the idea of spending a lot of money on expensive warships when we did not appear to have any enemies.
Well, Chairperson, as I was saying, I don't know, Mr. Holden. I don't know also why this reliance on Holden. I explained this earlier today, this morning. Indeed, Chairperson of the Commission, as you have indicated, that we took the decision to cancel that. I'm saying contract had not been signed, to terminate that process, because we're saying it's important to have an overall look at the needs of the National Defense Force. And not say today we'll buy for the Navy and then ask a question, well, what does the Air Force need and all of that. And that was the reason. Whatever Mr. Holden, he's entitled, of course, to his views, but that was the reason. Thanks.
Yes, Mr. Holden is one of the witnesses that will be giving evidence to this commission in due course. But I think in fairness to you, if you are able to add light to what is going on, then obviously you do so. If you don't remember, you don't remember, and I'm not going to try and force you. I'm not here to force you to remember things that you don't remember. It's a long time ago, and a lot of water has flowed under the bridge since then. Let's get on with the job. As regards the Air Force, my instructions are that in October of 1995, the Air Force did an analysis of its needs, and it said, all we need to do is to replace the Cheetah trainer aircraft that were then in service in South Africa. They've since been sold to Ecuador, as you probably know. But my question is, were you aware that the Defense Force was not at that time asking for expensive Hawks and Gripens?
I'm sorry, before the former president replies, Mr. Hoffman, please try and put to the witness the correct facts. The evidence that we had from the SNDF does not accord with what you said. At no stage did they say that they do not want to replace the Cheetahs. As I understood the evidence, the Cheetah's lifespan was almost coming to an end. And then two, the Alouette's lifespan had come to an end. And they set out exactly what their requirements were. I don't remember the type of evidence that you are saying that was led by any one of the Air Force members or the SANDF. Maybe try and put a proper proposition to the witness so that I can get an answer from him.
Mr. Commissioner, my function is not to put what the SANDF has come and said before this commission. My function here is to put my instructions and to seek to help you to find out whether you are being told the truth when you are told what you are told by officials who have whatever reasons they may have to tell you what they tell you. But simply because they have told you something does not turn it into the Holy Grail. It is their evidence, and I am on the instructions of my client to put to this witness, who is the man on whose desk the buck stopped, what other people say was actually going on at the time. That's my job.
I agree with you. In other words, if I understand you well, this is the evidence that your client is going to lead. Thank you.
My client and Mr. Holden, who is the source of the information, let's just take a step back.
Just hold on. You're saying that your client and Mr. Holden, that is the evidence that they're going to lead before the commission.
Correct. And
then in that case, you are entitled to put that question to you.
And they will say also that Ecuador has bought those cheetahs, and those cheetahs are still in service in Ecuador.
Just hold on, Mr. Hoffman. I see Advocate DeForce at the back is raising a hand.
I don't know who that is.
Yes, Advocate DeForce?
Mr. Chair, I act on behalf of Mr. Holden, and obviously I cannot object to whatever is put on behalf of Mr. Terry Crawford Brown to Mr. Mbeki, as long as it's clear that whatever instructions Mr. Hoffman is putting to Mr. Mbeki does not come from my client.
I'm waiting for this. What I thought, I was a bit surprised that, you know, Mr. Hoffman now is acting also for Mr. Holden and Mr. Crawford Brown. Now, by the way, thanks a lot for clarifying that. Mr. Hoffman, you are not acting on behalf of Mr. Holden.
The version of Mr. Holden
will be put by Advocate DeForce, sitting right at the back there. She's acting for Mr. Holden. Thank you. Maybe let's proceed.
What I can put on behalf of Mr. Terry Crawford Brown is that at the time, which was in 1995, the cheetahs then in service in the South African Air Force had a 12-year lifespan, and they were sold to Ecuador, and that they are still being used in Ecuador to this day.
That's where they had particular committee.
I misspoke. My learned friend is quite right. He was the chairman of the Interministerial Committee. I take it back, and I apologize for wasting the commission's time.
No, the commissioners, I don't know anything about this report. It never arose in terms of the work of the Interministerial Committee.
You referred in your evidence in chief to the defense white paper that was produced early in your term of office. And I want to suggest to you that my information is that that happened in May of 1996, and that the Department of Defense asked for a balance to be struck between what was then the RDP, the Reconstruction and Development Program, and the need to prepare the country for any military eventuality. Is that a fair summary of how you recall the white paper?
Commissioners, I would imagine indeed that would have been the attitude of government. I wouldn't be surprised. I haven't read that white paper for many years. I wouldn't be surprised if it reflected what government thought.
Thank you, Mr. Mbeki. We're making progress now. And of course, what was in front of the stove at the time was the notion that the primary object of the Defence Force is to defend and protect the Republic, our territorial integrity, our people, and the principles of international law in relation to the use of force. That's really what it was about. Those were the principles that we were now bringing to bear in the new South Africa.
That's what is reflected in the Constitution, but in the process of the defense review and discussion of defense policy, defense posture, This matter, of course, was also added that South Africa had an obligation towards the rest of the African continent.
Yes, that was part of that African Renaissance in which you and I have participated. The question that I have to raise with you seriously is, what military eventualities were you, as chairman and deputy president, aware of at the time that these considerations were on the table and that this white paper was there?
Commissioners, the views of government with regard to threats and all of that are reflected both in the white paper and the defense review. As a person, I don't have any views that are different from those.
You are not personally aware of any possible threat, nor are you surprised to discover, as we sit here in 2014, that none of those weapons that we obtained, or none of the armaments that we obtained, have ever been used in anger in South Africa since then.
No, commissioners, I'm saying my personal views are entirely irrelevant here. What we're talking about here are government decisions, and the government decisions are explained in the documents to which I have referred, and I think that is what is material to the work of the commission.
Perhaps I should ask you the question a little bit more bluntly, even though I'm trying not to be blunt with you. Are you aware of any tactical or defensive use that the corvettes, the submarines, and the jets that we have acquired under this deal have been put since we bought them?
Chairperson, while I was in government, where I was sitting in government, check on the operations of submarines and ships. Where was the submarine yesterday? Where was this aircraft another day? What were they doing? I'm sure that people in the National Defense Force and Defense Department can answer that question.
Thank you, Mr. Mbeki. I suppose that that would be a more appropriate official to deal with the matter. The instructions that I have is that about half of the aircraft are actually still in their packing cases. They haven't been unpacked. That two of the submarines are unusable, and that the corvettes have got all kinds of frigates have got all kinds of technical problems, which mean that they decorate the harbour at Simonstown more than do anything else. But if you have not been following
Mr. Hoffman, please, we don't have time. Can we get straight into the cross-examining of the former president? That type of information, you can discuss it at a later stage when your client testifies. There's no need for you to go on in detail trying to tell the president what your clients are going to testify about if he says that he doesn't have any personal knowledge of that. Let's just try and save time. Get on with your questions without making long statements, please.
Now, Mr. Commissioner, I will attempt to avoid long statements and stick to facts. I'm instructed that in March of 1997, the South African National Defence Force had received bids from 23 different suppliers for the provision of fighter trainer jets and made a shortlist of four. And neither the Hawks nor the Gripens made that shortlist. Do you remember that in the processes of your committee that you chaired and for which you were collectively responsible?
No, Chairperson, I don't.
I'm also instructed that on the 18th of June of 1997, The South African cabinet approved the defense review and made a decision that South Africa needs to undertake extensive purchases to maintain the capacity of our defense force. Do you remember making that decision?
Yes, a decision was taken, Commission, by Cabinet to acquire the equipment as indicated in the defense review.
Thank you, Mr. Mbeki. Now we're getting there. July 1997 was the month in which you as... I suppose then it would still have been President Mandela in July 97. An appointment was made for the first time ever to have a South African consul general in the city of Hamburg. Did you participate in any way in that decision?
Consuls general appointed by the Department of Foreign Affairs or the Department now of International Relations. They would have nothing to do with the presidency.
So you're saying it was a departmental decision, not a presidential decision?
Let me repeat. Consular officials decided upon by then the Department of Foreign Affairs or the current Department of International Relations, and they've got nothing to do with the presidency.
Perhaps you would enlighten the Commission as to why it was necessary to appoint a gentleman by the name of Mo Sheikh to be the Consul General of South Africa in Hamburg for a period of only 3 months, given that the city of Hamburg is the hometown of Blom and Voss, which was one of the companies in the German frigate consortium.
Advocate Merani.
Chair, I think Mr. Mbeki has said twice that was not a presidential appointment. It was a departmental appointment by Foreign Affairs, as it was then called. Now to start cross-examining the witness about why a particular person was appointed, it's taking us nowhere.
Advocate Hoffman.
Thank you, Mr. Commissioner.
Otherwise, do you want the former state president to start speculating?
No,
because it clearly say that was not his function.
I'm not asking him about the appointment. He's told us that appointment wasn't made by him or anybody in the cabinet. It was made by Foreign Affairs, and I accept that answer. I'm not attacking it. What I'm asking him is why was it necessary for his government, in which he was the deputy president, to put Mo Sheikh in Hamburg for 3 months, the home of Blom and Voss. He either knows why or he doesn't know why.
He's going to speculate. He didn't make that decision. I'm not going to allow the question. Let's get to the next question.
I don't know why it would be speculation with respect, Mr. Commissioner, because if he knows why Mo Sheikh went to Hamburg, he will tell us why Mo Sheikh went to Hamburg. If his learned counsel and the Commission are not prepared to give him the opportunity of answering that question, then I'm afraid getting at the truth of why Mo Sheikh spent 3 months in Hamburg.
Just so, even difficult. Before you go on, Mr. President, do you know why Foreign Affairs did what they did?
No, Chairperson, I wouldn't. They would take decisions. I said all matters relating to consular matters were decided by the department. Who goes to which capital, what car do they drive, what shoes do they wear, that departmental matter has nothing to do with the presidency.
Thank you. Let's get to the next question now.
In the following month, that's now August of 1997, I'm given to understand that the South African Parliament actually approved the defense review, which was the open sesame for the arms deal process to start moving. Does that accord with your recollection? You gave evidence to that effect earlier without giving dates. Is that the sort of date that would have happened?
Chairperson, I'm not sure about the months and so on, but the fact that the Parliament approved the defence review is correct.
I'm also instructed, Mr. Mbeki, that on the 2nd of October 1997, you made an announcement that South Africa would reopen tenders for the purchase of arms, and that the total cost that you were envisaging when you made that announcement was the princely sum of 12 billion rand. Do you recall making that announcement?
No, I don't.
Do you dispute that you made that announcement?
I can't dispute it. I said I don't know. Can't recall it.
Thank you, Mr. Mbeki. You're being very fair, and I think we will go faster if we go this way. I want to now take you to the work of Mr. Joe Modisi, which was taking place in October of that same year. And the instruction that I have to put to you, because I'm trying to do my job properly, is that the South African Air Force Command Council met to decide on the force structure that would be used in the new South Africa, and they received strict instructions from Joe Modisi, who at the time was the Minister of Defence, and with whom, as you have correctly conceded, you were collectively responsible, that there would be a three-tier system in the tendering, and that as a result, the BAE Gripen and the Hawk could be resubmitted for evaluation, even though they had fallen off the table at an earlier stage in the proceedings. So by the end of that month, let's stop there, and I'll ask you the second half of the question about the end of the month later. This is a big decision. I mean, this idea to have the three-tier system, does this ring any bells with you, or is it something that you were allowing your committee to do with just overall supervision on your part?
No, I'm Minister of Defence and Department of Defence might have done exactly what he says as a commissioner. I don't know what they decided there. What I would know is what was brought to the Interministerial Committee.
That was the second part of my question.
Just hold on, Mr. Hoffman. Mr. Hoffman, I was just discussing with my fellow commissioner here. I noticed that you are reading a book. I'm not sure whose book it is. And keep on saying, this is my instruction. Who are you referring to when you say, this is my instruction? Who would have instructed you?
My instruction comes from Terry Crawford Brown, who is sitting on my left. The book, as I've explained already to the witness and the commission, comes from Paul Holden, who is a South African historian who has written two books about the arms the arms deals. The first one, from which I draw this information, is called The Arms Deal in Your Pocket. That's the book that I'm leading out of, and it has a chronology which was placed before the Constitutional Court.
Just hold on, Mr. Hoffman, I understand that. I just wanted to understand when you say my instructions are, from whom are you getting those instructions?
I mean, getting my instructions from Terry Crawford Brown, because he
has. And not from Mr. Holden, because Advocate DeForest is acting for Mr. Holden. So the propositions that we are putting forward is what your client is also going to testify about.
That is so. That is so.
Thank you.
I cannot put instructions from people who do not instruct me. That would be wrong.
No, it will be wrong. But then what worries me is that earlier on you said that you're acting on instructions from Mr. Holden, and it turned out that is not correct. This is why we feel that it's necessary for us to ask this question.
No, I was saying it was information compiled by Mr. Holden, and if I said instructions by mistake, then I apologize.
Let's leave it at that. But then I suppose Advocate DeForest also understood you the same as I did. But we can go ahead then now. Yes. You are not acting on behalf of Mr. Holden.
The information
that you are using to cross-examine, this is the evidence that is going to be given by Mr. Crawford Brown, for whom you are now acting.
Yes. And I stress for the record that this chronology, which I am using at the moment, was placed before the Constitutional Court and confirmed on oath by Mr. Crawford Brown when he made the application to court that led to this Commission of Inquiry being appointed.
Mr. Hoffman, that all we know, you have said that many times in the past. Can you continue with the cross-examination?
I'm very happy to do that. Thank you for the opportunity. So the second part of the question in relation to Joe Medici's three-tier system that let the Hawks and the Gripens back into the system is that by the end of October of 1997, there were three preferred suppliers for the supply of the Alpha jets that were chosen. And at first, the Gripen was the lowest rated of all of the choices due to its cost. I think we're at idem about that. You mentioned already that the Gripen was more expensive than the others in the race.
We're talking about the Hawk, not the Gripen.
Are you able to confirm that the Gripen was, in fact, the lowest rated? Did you look at the ratings at the time?
I don't remember the commission, any presentation made to the interministerial committee which said that.
Now, as at 1998, Joe Medici was the life president of the MK Veterans Association. Is that right?
He may very well have been a commissioner, I don't know.
And you won't know whether BAE made a donation to that organization?
No, that's not a matter I had to deal with.
But it is so that Mr. Modisi was a political ally of yours in the political activities that took place around that time.
Chairperson, I think I would like to request, with your permission, that the advocate explains that. I don't understand it. What's this political ally about what?
Let me put it in this the way that my note reads is, Joe Medici was the kingmaker of Thabo Mbeki because Thabo Mbeki wanted to succeed Nelson Mandela, and there are various other political people who wanted to do likewise, and with his support, you became the second president of the liberated South Africa. That's the question I'm asking you, and I would appreciate an answer.
Advocate Merlin, I see you wanted to say something to this.
That is so, Chairperson. I do not see how Mr. Terry Crawford Brown can give that evidence. And in any event, it is totally irrelevant to the issues that this commission has to decide. My learned colleague is obviously reading from some book written by some person, and he seems to be relying on the truth of that, and that is not even his client. I do not know how we can vouch for the accuracy of all these statements.
Mr. Hoffman?
I have already confirmed, in case Mr. Morani was distracted at the time, that what I am putting is put on the instructions of Mr. Crawford Brown. Mr. Crawford Brown has been involved in the politics of the arms deals since since before the arms deals with the, since 1989 he's been involved in it, and he has taken a close interest in it, and he's written two books of his own, which I am being careful not to quote from, because he will give evidence about what he said in his own books. What I have done in relation to the Holden book is made careful cross-reference to see where Holden and Crawford Brown coincide and overlap. And that is why this is being done. And I don't know why we are being so coy about the fact, which everybody in this room knows, is that Joe Madisi was the kingmaker of President Mbeki at the time.
Mr. Hoffman, I don't think that statement is correct. You say everybody knows. For instance, I'm one of those who doesn't know. And I'm sure there might be other people who doesn't know. Commissioner Musa also doesn't know that. And I think that question, in any event, is irrelevant. I'm not going to allow it. Let's get to the next point.
According to the information that I am instructed with, and this was accepted by the High Court, the Supreme Court of Appeal, and the Constitutional Court in the matter of the state versus Shabir Sheikh, which we're going to have to discuss in some detail at some stage, what happened on the 17th of March of 1998 is that Shabir Sheikh wrote a letter to the head of Thompson CSF, which was one of these arms deal bidders, a man called Perrier, telling him that Mr. Jacob Zuma, who was then, I think, a MEC for Economic Affairs, wants to discuss Thompson's uncertainty about including Inkobi Holdings as a partner in Thompson CSF, in Thompson ADS bid for the delivery of the corvettes that South Africa was looking at, and that that letter was copied to you, Mr. Mbeki. So while Mr. Morani is formulating his objection, let's hear whether you got a copy of that letter that Sheikh has been found beyond a reasonable doubt to have written and to have copied to you.
I'm sorry, before Advocate Morana comes in, you say what is the date of that letter?
The date of the letter, according to my instructions, is the 17th of March 1998. And the reference, according to my instructions, to Inkobi is a reference to a company that was initially formed by Shabir Sheikh and named after a deceased prominent ANC politician. And if I'm wrong with any of that, I'm happy to be corrected either by interventions or by the witness who I'm trying to interrogate in this inquiry.
Mr. Melanie.
Chairperson, firstly, my learned friend is not allowed to interrogate any witness. Secondly, this issue of what transpired during the Shabir Sheikh case relating to any correspondence between Mr. Sheikh and Mr. Perrier or involving Mr. Zuma. Chairperson, those issues are certainly not relevant to this stage of the inquiry, certainly not relevant to the evidence that is given by former President Mbeki.
Maybe let's ask former President Mbeki if he knows anything about that letter. Do you know anything about that letter?
No, Chairperson, I don't. I'm not disputing at all that what the advocate might has just said. But I would imagine if there were ever any letter that was copied to the Deputy President of the Republic, it would be in the custody of the government.
And thank you for the intervention, Mr. Commissioner. It's helpful. I'm going to take you now all the way to April of 1998, and that is the month in which our South African National Defence Force committed itself to purchasing 24 lead-in fighter trainers, and when it made that commitment, 20 proposals from international companies were received, which were then whittled down to 4, the BAE Hawk, the Aeromachi MB339FD, and the Aeromachi MB339FD was, in fact, the South African Air Force's favored choice. Are you able to dispute any of that revelation of the prehistory of what we are here for today?
As I understand this matter, Chairperson, the Deputy Minister of Defense and people from Defense have presented evidence about this matter. And I have got nothing to add to what they said.
Fair enough, Mr. Mbeki. I'm not trying to put you in a box. I'm trying to use your wisdom and your experience.
Just hold, Mr. Hoffman. Advocate Sebeko.
Chair, just one matter that might bring some order to the process. It is apparent from the questions that Mr. Hoffman is putting to the former president, that there are some documents on which he relies for the questions that he has put. It would bode well for the proceedings if Mr. Hoffman would prepare a bundle of the documents that he intends to rely on for purposes of cross-examining the witness. But to the extent that the documents he seeks to rely on during the course of cross-examination are documents that have been produced before this commission, it would assist the witness somewhat if the documents are referred to as they have been presented to the commission to, at the very least, assist the witness in perhaps recalling some of the issues that Mr. Hoffman seeks to raise with the witness. I think it's only fair to the witness if that could be done.
Mr. Hoffman?
Mr. Chairman, I'm very happy to accept my learned friend's kind offer to produce documents that he would like to put in front of the witness if they are referred to during the course of the cross-examination. I'm in the middle of a cross-examination, which I don't want to waste the Commission's time with. I'm moving as fast as I can, and I'm not going to refer to documentation unnecessarily. I'm referring to a narrative now. I'm seeking to assist the Commission to get the story out in chronological order. That's what we're doing.
Thank you. Advocate Madeline, I think Mr. Hoffman, unless if I'm incorrect, he seems to be going through a book. Maybe if you're told that he's correct, it might assist if you're told, you know, he tells us which book is he going through so that the witness can also be given that book and all of us, we can then be in a position to be on the same page. Unless, if I'm incorrect, Mr. Hoffman, you are going through a book. You've got a book in front of you.
Mr. Commissioner, in the course of the week, I indicated to Mr. Madumbi, who is in charge of these things, that we would be using the volumes that are called, I think there are 8 of them, Terry Crawford Brown volumes. And this document is copied in that book. And I've told my learned friend who's been leading the witness this morning that if they wish to place, to use for their own purposes that document just for reference, or if they wish to go out and buy a copy.
Yeah, it is a book. Thank you. Advocate Moran.
Chairperson, we shall accept that my learned colleague Hoffman is going through a narrative. We certainly wouldn't like to waste any time standing down for documents to be presented. We're quite comfortable with the witness referring to somebody's opinion and calling that a narrative.
Okay, thank you. I forget, Hoffman, apparently
I'm
legal representative, they are happy that you continue in the way in which you...
I'm indebted to Mr. Morani for his generosity, and I will seek to avoid going into minutiae that may require documentation. There's more than enough documentation in this matter already. 30th of April in the year 1998 is the day on which Mr. Modisi instructed the team evaluating the purchase of the LIFT aircraft to adopt what he called the visionary approach to selecting the plans, so that there would be 2 separate evaluations and one would exclude cost as a criterion. You referred to this in your evidence in chief. Does this fit into the chronology?
No, I didn't refer to any such thing in my evidence in chief.
Does it fit into the chronology of your recollection that Mr. Modisi said, leave cost out of account in evaluating bids?
At no point did the interministerial committee leave any cost out. Thanks.
Is your evidence then that this well-documented, included in the JIT, evidence that Mr. Modisi said, let's adopt a visionary approach and leave cost out of consideration, never happened? Is that your evidence?
Chairperson, I'm not talking about Mr. Modise. I'm talking about the Interministerial Committee. I didn't sit in at meetings where the then Minister Modise was chairing or whatever. I'm talking about matters that were discussed at the Interministerial Committee. And what I'm saying is that at no point about anything did the Interministerial Committee take any decision without a reference to cost. Without reference to cost.
See, this is the first time that we are not really agreeing with each other, because it is well documented, and we will help you with the documentation after lunch so that we don't waste time now, that Mr. Modisi's idea of getting the BAE...
Mr. Hoffman, can we get to the next point? The witness clearly says that those meetings where Mr. Modisi was chairing, he was not present. He does not know what went on there. He was sitting as a chairperson of the Interministerial Committee. He can talk about what happened at that committee. This is what I think the witness needed to be saying. So whether you give him other documents or not, I'm not quite sure how that is going to help.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Commissioner. Let's do it this way. Do you agree with me, Mr. Mbeki, that it would be wrong to leave cost out of account in weighing a bid of this nature?
Chairperson, I don't understand that. What I've said is, the only reason I said before that there's no point at which the Interministerial Committee considered anything which, without addressing the matter of cost, naturally, because you've got to pay for it. So it was no possibility to sit and discuss, take decisions without having to answer the question, well, then how much are you going to pay for this? I think it's a straightforward issue. I can't remember. I don't know, unless I'm being a bit stupid. I don't know. Perhaps you could explain a bit better.
Mr. Mbeki, I'm sure you're not really stupid, but we're on a sensitive issue here. The blood pressure of Mr. Irwin behind you has gone up several levels, and I want you to apply your mind to what I'm putting to you now carefully.
Just hold on.
That is uncalled for.
I'm concerned for his health.
Ms. Hoffman, can you please only concentrate on what we are supposed to be doing? Mr. Owen is not one of the witnesses that we called today.
Yes. Mr. Mbeki, it goes like this. This procurement took place. Now, either that happened...
Or at what level are you referring to, Mr. Hoffman? I also don't understand the question. Mr. Mudisi was involved at the departmental level as a Minister of Defense, and he was chair of various committees. He was also a member of Cabinet, a member of the Interministerial Committee. The former State President says that he was sitting as a chairperson of the Interministerial Committee. Now, when you say Mr. Mudisi made that statement, at what level did he make the statement, so that we can also understand the question properly?
My instructions are that it was made in the context of giving an instruction to the team that was evaluating the purchase of aircraft.
So those instructions is what he gave them out at a departmental level.
That's how I understand the position, yes.
Thank you. Mr. Former President, do you know whether Mr. Mudisi gave those instructions to his department or not?
No, Chairperson, I don't. Indeed, as you've indicated, I've said this already, that we didn't sit in at meetings of departmental meetings. Minister Mudisi might very well have said all the things that you say he said within the department, but we sat as an interministerial committee, and this matter did not come to the ministerial committee of something which is not costed.
Because, Mr. Mbeki, you appreciate that it would be illegal and unconstitutional and invalid to leave cost out of consideration, don't you? You understand that that's wrong.
Yes. I honestly don't understand, Chairperson, what we are doing. I keep explaining that at no point did we as Interministerial Committee consider anything without taking cost into account. Exactly because we're conscious of our responsibilities with regard to that particular matter, with regard to cost. Now, I'm being asked a question about legality and illegality and so on. Sure, of course it would be illegal. But I'm saying that the very action we took exactly means that we had to discharge certain responsibilities and as cabinet committee we then did what we had to do.
As you have very correctly in your summary conceded, the cabinet in South Africa is collectively responsible for what cabinet ministers do, and if a cabinet minister invents a visionary approach that leaves costs out of account, then he is doing something that is deeply, darkly, unconstitutional and invalid. And let me, in the interest of giving you the opportunity to answer the question in an informed way, let me just refer you to the bits of the Constitution that count.
Mr. Hoffman, get on with the questions. We all know what the Constitution is saying. The former president, he knows what the Constitution is saying. Put your question to him.
My question is, how can it ever be cost-effective as required by Section 217 of the Constitution if you have a system in place put there by Joe Medici that says leave cost out of account when you're buying these aeroplanes?
Thank you. You don't have to answer that. Let's get to the next question. He said to you that he doesn't know what Mr. Medici did at the departmental level. If this is the evidence that you are going to give, then you can argue the question of constitutionality at a later stage. We haven't reached that stage as yet. Can we get to the next question?
I would prefer not to, Mr. Commissioner, because the witness was prepared to answer and you stopped him from answering. And I believe that his answer is critical to whether... we are participating in a farce or whether we are trying to get to the truth.
That's Mr. Hoffman, can you just be careful with your language? Can you be careful with your language? You say that the former... Mr. Mayran?
Chair, we would like our learned colleague to withdraw that statement, participating in a farce. That is contemptuous of this commission.
Yes, Hoffman?
I'm not prepared to retract that statement until such time as I have 13 answers from you, Mr. Commissioner, in relation to your...
Mr. Hoffman, if you don't stop talking about that, we are busy in the commission now. The witness is before us. If you thought that it was a farce, what do you want here now? Because we are talking about you cross-examining a particular witness, you go back to what happened sometime last month. And even at the beginning when we started, this is what you also did. You then referred to an incident where you came to the office in the evening, wanted to see me alone, and I refused. Now I see you are doing exactly the same thing. At the moment we are talking about whether the question that you put to this particular witness, whether it's a fair question or whether it's a question that will assist us or not. Can we try and restrict yourself to dealing with the questions of the witnesses before us?
Mr. Commissioner, with the greatest of respect, I have to insist that question is a question goes to the heart of what has happened here. If we have bought aeroplanes...
Just hold on. Can I perhaps suggest that if you want to, can you rephrase the question?
Yes, I'll rephrase the question.
Just try and do that. Let's see if each other witness will be in a position to...
I'm trying to take... I know that Mr. Commissioner, that you're impatient in relation to reiterating what the law is. But the point is that our law requires that a system of procurement using public money insists that cost effectiveness is a criterion, and that if cost effectiveness is just wiped off the table, that the contract that flows from that is invalid. It falls to be struck down by a court of law because it is not consistent with the Constitution. And the witness has been fair so far. I'm trying to see whether South Africa can be 70 billion rand better off because you, Mr. Commissioner, come to the conclusion that there was a contract here that did not comply with procurement requirements. And if there is a contract here that does not comply with procurement requirements because a minister said, forget about the cost, we're going to do the BAE Hawk Saab deal, whatever the cost, because we are adopting a visionary approach, then something not criminal, not bribery, not malfeasance, but a simple mistake in a new government in relation to what is meant to be done when you spend public money in a big way. And this was the biggest procurement ever in South Africa.
Mr. Hoffman, can you rephrase the question?
My question to Mr. Mbeki is a very simple one. Do you agree with me that it would be unconstitutional to leave cost out of account when you are required to do, by law, by the Constitution, to take cost effectiveness into account in your system of procurement? That's my question.
Chairperson, the Interministerial Committee, which made recommendations to Cabinet, that this is what we should do. Cabinet accepted those. Both of those committees at no stage considered these matters without taking into account cost. And I'm sure the Cabinet then, as I'm sure all of us here now are, we are very familiar with what the Constitution says about these matters. Thanks.
Mr. Mbeki, I have to tell you that when you were being led by my learned friend for the commission, you talked about the excessive cost of the hawks, and you suggested that the hawks were a better bet anyway because they fitted in better with the SAAF requirements, which is exactly the opposite of what I've put to you here, where they said they would prefer to have the Aero Mackie because it works better in South Africa. And now we sit with these aeroplanes in boxes, nobody to fly them, no fuel to put them in the air, doing less than 100 hours a year. Mr. Mbeki, I beg you, think about it. What have we done? What has your cabinet done?
Mr. Hoffman, I'm not going to allow you to go on in that particular way. If you want to put your question to the witness, make a proposition to the witness and let the witness answer. You can't make a very long statement. At the end of the day, I also end up not understanding what the question is. And I'm sure even the witness ends up not understanding what the question is.
I apologize. I'm due for my next pill, quite clearly.
Just hold on.
You know, Mr. Hoffman, I think it will help a great deal if you were to look at the record of the evidence left so far. It will help a great deal if you were to look at the record of the evidence left so far, especially around those matters you are talking about. It will help a great deal.
I'm afraid that the evidence that has been led thus far is part of a cover-up, and I don't believe it. That's the problem about looking at that evidence.
Is that those witnesses were not challenged. Their testimony was never challenged.
That is because I've come here today to not deal with minions, but to ask the man who was in charge what's going on. We've got limited capacity, we've got no funding, and we're here to ask the man in charge to answer for the collective responsibility which Mr. Commissioner, you know about because you know Section 92 of the Commission. We are not a big fat organization that can afford to send large teams of people such as those sitting on my left here day after day. It's impossible. What we have to do is use what we've got as best we can. And what concerns me is that Mr. Mbeki looks stricken at the moment. I'm not happy about what's happening here because 35 billion rand on aircraft that we've never used except for a
Mr. Hoffman, just so you have repeated that statement so many times this morning. Let me, Commissioner Moose wanted to say something before you finish.
You see, I'm raising this because a lot of your questions don't seem to have any relevance to what has been led before this commission. A lot of evidence has been laid around those issues you are talking about. And if you had cared to read the record, you'd be in a better position to ask even better questions relating to the very same matters you are raising now.
I think we are going to take the lunch adjournment. Probably when we come back after lunch, we might be in a position to do slightly better than we are doing up to now. Former President?
Chairperson, no, I don't want to, I'm not disagreeing with what you say. But I must say, Chairperson, I'm really quite angry at Mr. Hoffman. You're talking about my colleagues here as minions. These are not minions. They might be minions in his eyes, but I don't know if this entitles him to making statements like this. Privately, maybe he might want to say so. But I think it's very, very offensive, Chairperson. Thanks.
So, Hoffman, do you want to say anything to what has been said?
When I was, in fairness to Mr. Mbeki, when I was referring to minions, I was referring to the staff of the National Defense Force that has taken up a great deal of time here. I was not referring to his cabinet colleagues. And if he thought I was referring to his cabinet colleagues, I apologize and withdraw. It was very ambiguous to put it that way. And clearly, duly elected cabinet ministers are people of stature and people who deserve the respect of the public, but they are also people who are constrained by the requirements of the Constitution and cannot do as they please.
Thank you, Mr. Hoffman. I didn't thought that you were going to make a long statement like that. I think maybe you should just leave it at that. Let's adjourn and then we'll come back at 2 o'clock. Thank you.
They say tigers don't cry, but lawyers do cry. No, seriously. Bro Paul. No, they're gonna call me on my phone, Bro Paul. Yeah, we're waiting. Yeah. All right, sure. Yola. Yeah? Yeah? Hey, was I going to get the iPad? The plus. Ah, yeah. Yeah. Okay. Mr. Baloy. How are you doing, Nat? Oops, they must call again. Yeah, but for the bus of phone a foot. Call us. Can you tell them to call us? But phone Neil, and then they said they were going to call again. Yeah? No, they must call us. Oh, audio. I was a Kali Sumbeki. That I don't know. I'm Yeah? In? I was asking you to yes. Yeah? Yeah? All right. Mchela peg. Mchela, yeah, now we're for Mchela peg. Okay? Yeah? Oh. No, the phone is better. Yeah?
Hey, did you have one Peggy earpiece like Ninja?
Yeah, I know. Call. It means I have to hold it. No. You, yeah. Ah, you drop it.
Ah, you said I must answer.
You must, yeah.
Ah, we are okay.
But hold on to this one. Call, please. I'll just hold it like this. Okay, hello? Can you hear us now? Yeah. Okay. Yes, it has been a very emotional day indeed. Actually, the cross-examination started just over 40 minutes ago, and then they had to break for lunch a short while ago after a very emotional moment. We saw the lawyer representing whistleblower Terry Crawford Brown breaking down there as he was cross-examining the former President Thabo Mbeki, as he was asking him about why, regarding the Hawks contract, as to why cost was not considered. And then mostly we just had the former president saying that all the decisions that were taken as part of the interministerial committee, and then he does not know the other decisions that were taken by the then late defense minister, Joe Modise. It was a very emotional moment indeed for this lawyer representing Terry Crawford Brown as he kept on pushing, trying to get more information from the former president, saying that because the buck stopped with him, but we saw Judge Willie Seriti intervening almost every time intervening, saying that he was not going to allow a certain line of questioning. The hearings have adjourned for lunch now, and they will be resuming again in a short while, where the cross-examination will continue. Okay.